Hello there. My name is Leland Chang, and I'm from IBM. And I'm here to talk to you all a little bit today about voltage scaling and Vmin, which is a particularly important topic in the circuits community today because of the need for power efficiency. So what I hope to do in this video is to give you all a little bit of context as to how all the different components of Vmin fit together so that you might be able to design more power efficient circuits in the future. So let's start with a little definition here, because Vmin is a term that's been used for a lot of different things. In this context, we're going to assume that Vmin is the minimum supply voltage that can be used for a given VLSI chip. And of course, we're going to want to use the lowest possible voltage we can. And that's because power, of course, is a quadratic function of voltage. But we also have to remember that we have to meet our target chip specifications. And because the performance and functionality all has to be sufficient, performance in particular might be a challenging one because voltage scaling is going to degrade our transistor drive current, and performance, especially with Moore's law challenges, is going to be an issue that we're going to discuss. Functional margins are also going to be an issue. We can't forget about that either because variability and reliability are difficult challenges going forward. So in this video, we're going to focus on chip-level Vmin. That really means we're going to talk about digital logic and memory. Because that is what comprises most of VLSI chips today. We're not going to talk very much about analog and I/O circuits. These become very specialized and will be thus beyond the scope of this discussion. So I want to start with a cartoon of how all the different components of Vmin fit together. You can see here that we, as we discussed, we want chip functionality and performance to be acceptable for our chip. And we all know that we're going to have some nominal margin, voltage margin, that we're going to have to make sure this chip works. Then we're going to have to apply some variability margin and some reliability margin on top of that to make sure that we meet both metrics. So in this cartoon, I've shown that the performance limited Vmin is a little bit higher than the functionality limited Vmin. This is going to depend on our application. Sometimes it's going to be one, sometimes it's going to be the other. For example, for a logic path, it might be more performance limited, whereas for a memory path, it might be more functionality limited because memory is generally very sensitive to variability. We're going to talk about that in a later slide. Now, on top of this, we're going to have to apply a power delivery margin. And this is a little bit unusual for us chip designers to think about, but we have to remember that what we're trying to do at the end of the day is to design power-efficient systems. And we always have to deliver power from the wall plug out to our chip, and we're always going to incur some amount of IR drops and LDIDT noise. And so when we talk about Vmin, we're going to have to think about all of these all together. So we're going to talk about all these different components. The only one we're going to skip through a little bit is reliability. And that's for the sake of time. But for simplicity, we can think of reliability as somewhat as a temporal VT variation. And so we can lump that concept in with variability. So let's start with performance-limited Vmin. Usually when we get a chip out of the fab, we're going to measure the characteristics. And we're going to do a schmoo plot like this, where we plot frequency versus voltage. We're going to have regions in this plot where the chip is going to work, say green boxes, and regions where the chip is not going to work, red boxes. And we're going to have a boundary between these two regions, which normally looks like a line for most practical chips that we get. But based on this boundary, we're basically going to be able to figure out what the Vmin is. We're just going to read it off, because for a given frequency target here, there is going to be a minimum voltage at which we meet that performance. And so this is going to be the Vmin for a single chip. And there's probably not too much we're going to talk about here in this video to try to improve this particular single chip, because you have a fixed function, you're a great circuit designer, so you've probably already done really well there. What we're going to talk more about is populations of chips and how we deal with that. And that's because variability is obviously a very big concern for us these days. We know that when we get chips out of the fab, there's going to be a distribution of characteristics. There's going to be a worst case chip, which for performance limited Vmin is going to be the slowest chip. And that boundary curve that we saw in line that we saw in the previous chart is probably going to move higher here, such that we're going to have a higher Vmin for this worst case chip. So as a circuit designer, what we're probably going to focus on is actually trying to improve this performance limited Vmin by either minimizing our transistor variability, trying to stop the problem at the source. We can either, say, for example, use wider transistors that vary less, or we can use a lower VT on these transistors such that the gate overdrive does not get degraded when we have variability. So we're obviously going to incur some trade-offs here because of capacitance and maybe leakage, but it will allow us to achieve a lower Vmin, which is what we're trying to do. We'll push this curve lower. The other thing we can try to do is to minimize the circuit variability margin that we have to apply to tolerate variation. We're just going to get what we get, and then we're going to shave the margin as small as we can People have proposed a lot of ways to do this with critical path timing monitors or maybe asynchronous circuits, all focusing on bringing that margin as small as we can so that the Vmin that we actually realize in the chip can be as close to the nominal as possible so the Vmin can actually be improved. So speaking of variability, we're going to talk a little bit more now about functionality-limited Vmin. In particular, we're going to focus on SRAM. And this is because variability actually is probably much more important in this case than the performance-limited Vmin that we just discussed. SRAM Vmin has been a very, very hot topic in the research world in recent years because SRAM is so incredibly limited by random variation. This is because there's sort of a perfect storm of a couple of issues coming together to really make SRAM Vmin very difficult to optimize. The first is because SRAM is generally made out of the smallest transistors on the chip, and you have very, very high VT in these devices to try to keep the leakage down. But that leads to very, very large random variation. The sigma VT that you might see, this is based on, say, statistical dopant fluctuation modeling, you can see that a small device with small dimensions, a high doping concentration, it's going to lead to a very large sigma VT. So you're going to get a lot of variation in your transistors to begin with. But what makes it worse is that the cell operation of your traditional 6T SRAM cell is very, very sensitive to the transistor strength ratios. That's because we use the same devices for both the read and the write operations. It's these passgate devices right here. And you can imagine that you want them to be incredibly strong to write the cell, but then you don't want them to be too strong when you read the cell because you don't want to accidentally write the cell. And so you can imagine there's a delicate balance that you have to preserve, and once you have variability, this is going to be a challenge. And finally, statistics are not in your favor, because on a given VLSI chip these days, you might have megabytes, many, many megabytes of SRAM, and then you have to think about the tails of the distribution, you know, out to 5, 6 sigma, everything has to work. You also don't get any averaging. If you're talking about random variation for, say, a logic path, then each successive stage is going to average the random variation out a little bit. But in an SRAM cell, you've got to access that cell. It's got to work. And so this is going to be very, very challenging. So as I mentioned, the SRAM guys in the world have worked very hard on this problem over the last several years, tried all kinds of different solutions. Most of the most effective ones have boiled down to basically just this. We focus on the peripheral circuits. We try to do read and write assist circuits, so we tune the cell as much as we can, and then we focus on the peripherals to try to increase the margins as much as we can beyond that. And so what we're trying to do in all these cases is some type of dynamic modulation of the device strengths. So we'll play with the bitline and word line voltages, we'll create new voltages locally that are, say, in between 0 and VDD, or maybe even outside, higher or lower, and we're going to try to drive the different devices either more weakly or more strongly to try to get more read versus write operating margin. And so this is going to decouple the read versus write operations and thus bias a lot of Vmin. For high performance applications, we may not be willing to do some of these techniques because these, you can imagine, you might incur some timing penalty because you're trying to generate these voltages. There's some pulsing and capacitive boosting involved very often. And so there we might use, say, dual supplies. We might use explicit supply voltages for this. We might even add some extra transistors to the cell to try to really decouple the read and the write. So now I want to talk a little bit about power delivery. As I said, we are chip designers, but we have to think about the end product. And when we talk about Vmin, this is particularly important because when we look at Vmin, it could be different whether we're talking about Vmin at the circuit, out at the C4s, or maybe out at the voltage regulator module. Because we have parasitics on the board and the package and the back end, there are IR drops and there are LDIDTs going on everywhere. And this is going to be challenging, especially at low voltage, because if we fix the power, then current's going to go up. And obviously IR, LDIDT, these are all going to go up as well. So this is definitely something we have to think about when we're talking about Vmin and how we're defining Vmin even. As a circuit designer, what we're going to have to think about is trying to improve the margins for both IR and LDIDT. Decoupling capacitance is a passive way of doing this to try to improve the LDIDT margin. We might try to add dedicated structures on the chip to put a lot of capacitance there. We might put, say, linear regulators to try to do some active VDD regulation to compensate some of the LDIDT drops. Or a more exotic technique that's actually becoming much more practical these days is trying to deliver our power through all our parasitics at a high voltage. So we keep it at a high voltage here so the current levels are lower. And then we bring it to the chip. And what we have to do on the chip is now step that voltage down to the actual VDD that we want. But this can help to mitigate the margins that we have to apply. So I want to finish this video with a little discussion about how our jobs as circuit designers are going to relate to our friends over in the technology side of things, and also our friends over on the system architecture side of things. First with technology, obviously we all know that technology progresses very quickly. There are new things going on all the time. For example, one of the big things these days is FinFET, starting 22 nanometer node, going to 16 and 14. This is what everyone is using. It brings some very interesting things that help us with Vmin, and there are also some challenges as well. The structure itself is quite wonderful for gate length scaling with low channel doping. So you can imagine that that better scaled device is going to be higher current at low VDD. It's going to have lower sigma VT because of the channel doping. So these are going to be good things for Vmin. But at the same time, it's a vertical structure. It's quantized when you want to change the fin width. You can only put two fins, three fins, integer numbers of fins. The vertical structure is going to lead to a very strong PFET drive strength. And so these two issues together are actually going to limit your SRAM tuning capability a little bit. And so that's actually going to hurt your Vmin in that case. So you're going to get some pluses. You're going to get some minuses. The pluses probably outweigh the minuses. But there's a little trade-off, and we're going to have to understand, as circuit designers, what we're going to have to really focus on. The other thing we're going to have to remember is that technology guys will always improve process control. Variability is going to get better and better as time goes on. Ideas like directed self-assembly that are pretty exotic may sometime come into play, and thus we will probably be able to improve our Vmin just from these types of ideas. So the thing to remember, the issues that we've discussed and the solutions that we've discussed so far, they will probably always be needed, because we're always going to want to get the lowest voltage we can possible. But we should keep in mind that technology progress will, for the most part, help to improve Vmin. So finally, I want to say a few words about application dependencies, because while all the issues we've discussed in this video are probably common to any application, you're always going to have to worry about performance and functionality and power delivery. But whether you're talking about a low-power, low-cost part or a high-performance part that you're trying to build at the end of the day, the trade-offs and the key issues that you need to be very good at are all going to be very different. And so really, at the end of the day, you want to know what different Vmin solution options you have out there, and you're probably going to choose different ones whether you're in one camp or the other. So just to summarize, I hope I've convinced you that understanding Vmin is very important in power efficiency for VLSI design today. We've talked a little bit about performance and functionality limits, and we've talked about how variability and reliability margins come into play. We've also talked about power delivery. So beyond the chip itself, the system is really what we want to think about. So there's a lot for us as designers to do. We really need to remember to talk to our technology friends and our applications system designer friends to understand how technology is going to evolve, as well as how customer needs are going to evolve in the future. Thank you very much.